Jen Tayabji. I am the executive director here at the Illinois Disciples Foundation. And Bill served on our board for quite some time, and that's how I got to know him. I want to welcome all of you for coming, and thank you for coming, especially for those families who've had to travel a bit longer distance than some of us in town. It's definitely tragic that we're here today, because we've lost a very good friend, a true activist, and a comrade. But I hope today that we will remember Bill and what he taught us. Bill served on the IDF board since 1997, and he served loyally as our secretary, which is a very fun task if for anyone who's had to do it. It's a lot of note-taking, and he kept us on our toes. He'd always put something in the minutes that we'd have to take out, but it was definitely very, very funny, just not appropriate for board minutes. And so it was always fun to read them to see what he had hidden in there somewhere. The IDF is a Peace with Justice campus ministry, and we work on a lot of different issues, including racism, peace and anti-war, international issues of human rights, labor justice, education, healthcare, and more. And we are definitely glad to be able to help host the memorial because Bill served so loyally at the IDF for almost 10 years. In a minute, I'm gonna introduce Claudia, but I wanted to share kind of a personal story or my reflections on Bill before we move forward. I've known him I knew him for about 7 years. And one of the first things that happened is I got on his email list. And for those of you on it, you got multiple emails per day, mostly from Molly Ivan's articles. And when I was thinking of Bill yesterday as I was trying to write this, I was thinking of Molly Ivan's because someone that I think had the same sort of wit and someone that Bill was a huge fan of. And Molly Ivan said, satire is traditionally the weapon of the powerless against the powerful. And I think that's definitely true. And Bill is someone I think who was able to put that into activism. He was always the most dedicated, but he always had that sense of humor there too that made it that much more fun and kept us more sane. And I always think before there was The Daily Show, there was Bill. He definitely had that humor down way before Jon Stewart and The Daily Show. And when I began working on social justice work, I really thought everyone was always so serious that to be an activist must mean you have to be serious all the time. And Bill was the one that taught me that that's not true. You can be funny and you can have a really twisted sense of humor and still be the most committed activist. And that was something I think that I will always carry with me. I will always be striving to be as witty and as funny as he is and to also be as such a good social critic. And he was just so dedicated to his work. And even the days, you know, he's usually very quiet. And for the days that he was in a grumpy mood, it was always under the surface, that wit. You know, it was always ready to come out. And that was the greatest thing, because there's so many days that I'd have a bad day, I'd be upset about something, and I'd get an email, or I'd talk to him on the phone, or see him in person, and he would say something that just kind of made my bad day go away, that just made things seem so much better, and I definitely laughed a lot. And I have definitely been touched by that twisted sense of humor of his, and I will definitely carry it with me, because it brings me sanity in doing activism work, and it makes me laugh when I need a laugh. So, on behalf of IDF, I want to extend our deepest condolences to the family and to the friends and everyone in the community. The IDF joins the community in mourning Bill's passing, and I think most importantly, in celebrating his life, in his overflowing passion for social justice work and his unrelenting and always hilarious critique of society. So that's something I hope we can remember and carry forward. At this time, I would like to introduce Claudia Lenhoff.
Good evening. I'm Claudia Lenhoff, and I'm the director at Champaign County Healthcare Consumers, and I have the honor and privilege of knowing virtually everybody who's here. And likewise, want to thank you for coming here. I want to thank the IDF for hosting this important tribute to Bill here. We appreciate that, and especially thanks to Jen and Aaron, who worked hard to put the room together. On a housekeeping detail, I just wanted to mention that for those of y'all who have cell phones, you might want to turn them off or turn them on to buzzer so as to not be disruptive and to not feel embarrassed when that happens. So this is a very difficult process. Grieving is hard. I expect this evening that it's quite all right to cry. It's also quite all right to laugh. It's hard to say goodbye to somebody, and in the process of saying goodbye, you want them to stay more than ever. But also in the process, hopefully, we are also aware of the gifts that have been given and that continue with us. And so this is a very communal process of grieving. The Champaign County Healthcare Consumers, the Illinois Disciples Foundation, the Dental Access Program, all of us who work together and struggle, and Bill's family also, this is community, and community is it's a form of family, and so this is a very communal grieving process, and thank you all for sharing and also for celebrating Bill's life and work. I just want to tell you a little bit about the program for this evening here, and so that you know what to expect. And we're going to have a few speakers who are going to pay tribute to Bill, and I will come up and introduce each speaker. I will also deliver a eulogy, which I gave at the church in Springfield when the family held a memorial for Bill. And then we're going to have probably about 20 minutes of film and slides of Bill, and I feel very happy when I see those. So hopefully everybody will like that. And then afterwards, we're going to have food and just socializing. So I think the program part of the evening is probably about an hour or so. Be patient with us if it's less or a little bit longer, but I think that's how it'll go. And later on, you will hear from the family, but I just wanted to welcome Bill's family who traveled here from Springfield and other parts, and some family members may speak if they feel that they want to, but I just wanted to welcome the family here. Bill's brother, Krohn, and his wife, Petra, came here, and also his sister, Anne, and his nieces and nephew, his niece, Jess, nephew, Ben, niece, Hannah, and Sarah are here, and they're famous among those of us who got Bill's emails a lot of times, so thank you and welcome. And now what I'd like to do is ask Paulette Coleman to come up. She's an organizer at Champaign County Healthcare Consumers.
Good evening. Good evening. It's an honor for me to be standing here in front of you on behalf of my friend Ben. My name is Paulette Coleman, and I am a community organizer for the Champaign County Healthcare Consumers. I am one of Bill's co-workers, and I have the honor, and privilege, and joy of working with Bill since 1998. I want to take a moment to introduce you to the rest of the healthcare consumer staff who are here today, who work with Bill day in and day out, and then I'm going to read a short poem that I wrote for Bill. As I introduce you, would you please stand? Bill's co-workers at CCHCC family are Katie Coombs, Allison Jones, remain standing, please. Claudia Linhoff, Jeff Machoda, Sharon Pan, Mike Cruz, Stephanie Green, Cindy McDowell, and Jake. Rachel, please stand, and Jake. There are many other people who work with Bill, including our board members, but we can't all meet one another during the social time following the memorial. Now I would like to read a poem for Bill. Before I say this, you know, sometimes when you work with people for a really long time, you kind of take a lot of things for granted. You don't say thank you, and you don't say please. And I think when Bill passed, I realized that. So I wrote this. Thank you for being our friend and our family. Thank you for your guidance through your wisdom and your support. Thank you for your quiet kindness through your compassion and understanding. Thank you, Bill. We love you. Thank you.
I'm going to give the eulogy that I gave at the Christ Episcopal Church in Springfield on Friday, March 31st, and I'm going to do that, and then we'll have some more speakers. Okay. Again, my name is Claudia Lenhoff, and I'm the Executive Director of the Champaign County Healthcare Consumers, where Bill and I have worked together since 1997. I am profoundly honored to be able to help celebrate and pay tribute to Bill's work and life and character. Bill and I have worked closely together for over 9 years, and I consider Bill my best friend. His enduring love and friendship have forever graced my life. Unfortunately for Bill, as he would well know, throughout our 9 years of working together, Bill wrote most of the speeches that I ever gave. And now, when I'm charged with what I consider the most important one of all, Bill isn't here to write it for me. Bill was an incredible and brilliant writer, and he helped make us all look incredible and brilliant. Now alone, with my own inadequate words and my own clumsy way, I will do my best to help pay tribute to Bill, your beloved son, brother, uncle, and friend, and our beloved friend and coworker. The reason that I do not fear this task, although I know that without Bill I am not so eloquent or graceful, is because the eloquence and grace of Bill's life and work will speak for itself. And so I want to tell you about our beloved Bill and the stunning and vast impact that he has had on our lives and the lives of thousands of people in this community. But first, to Bill's family, I want to say to you that Bill loved you all profoundly, and he was absolutely devoted to you. He did not take your love for granted. He felt graced and awed by your love. He spoke of you all frequently, and we have come to know you through him. He had such affection, such respect, and such love for you all, and you brought him so much comfort and joy. This has been abundantly clear in all the years that I have known Bill. Bill, in his quiet, gentle, and steadfast way, created a sense of family and community among so many of us. I want to tell you now about how we know Bill, who he is to us and the people here in our community, and the vast community around the nation that he has patiently, quietly, and tenderly created, and with whom he has shared his passion for justice, compassion for people, and what I consider to be his delightfully twisted and irrepressible sense of humor. We at the Champaign County Healthcare Consumers know Bill as a deeply committed activist who dedicated the last 9 years of his life to working for social justice. The Healthcare Consumers is a grassroots citizen action organization with the mission of healthcare for all and a dedication to ensuring the people have a voice in the healthcare system. Bill's passion for social justice and his commitment to social change to improve the lives of others brought him to our organization in 1997, where he has worked as both a community organizer as well as the coordinator of our consumer health hotline and dental referral program. And I just want to note that I'm forever grateful. Nancy Greenwalt is here. She was the director of Healthcare Consumers at the time, who hired Bill. In his capacity as the coordinator of the hotline and dental referral program, Bill was responsible for working with clients who were having problems with the healthcare system. Overwhelmingly, these were people who couldn't get the healthcare that they needed and that their health and lives depended upon. Frequently, when these clients turned to our organization for help, we were their last resort after everyone else had failed them. They were desperate and scared and at the end of their ropes. These clients were overwhelmingly low income and uninsured or uninsured people. Many were seniors or people with disabilities. Anyone could have buckled under the weight of the responsibility of this job and the overwhelmingly desperate situations our clients were in. Bill worked one-on-one with these clients, and over the years, he has literally helped thousands of Champaign County residents get the health care they needed. Without Bill, many of these people would have gone without the care they needed, and their health and lives would have unraveled tragically. Bill didn't just help people get the health care they needed. He interacted with them in kind, respectful, patient, and gentle ways. and he helped bring them hope and comfort when they had none. All of us who work with Bill came to admire and respect his compassionate and patient manner, how he could offer solace and hope to desperate people. If there was a way to help a person, Bill would find it. Through his interactions with clients, I came to see Bill as a gentle soul with a tender heart. Beyond helping clients, part of Bill's job was to train volunteers to work as advocates with these clients. Bill has earned the loyalty, love, and respect of hundreds of volunteers in our organization. He has nurtured and supported so many fine young people who have gone on to do social justice work around the country as a result of their experiences working with Bill and our organization. When word of Bill's death reached these young people, many of whom are now living and working in other communities, they responded with their sympathies and overwhelmingly described Bill as a friend and a mentor, and talked about his devotion to social justice and his compassion for people. Several of Bill's former volunteers are public interest lawyers, doctors, nurses, labor union organizers, and healthcare administrators, all out there making the world better. Bill's greatest impact, however, was as a community organizer, where he could work for systemic change that would lead to concrete improvements in the lives of thousands of Champaign County residents and the lives of people beyond our community. As an organizer, Bill worked mostly behind the scenes. He preferred to remain in the background most of the time. Bill was a brilliant and resourceful researcher and writer, and he could also always be counted on to do many of the thankless jobs that are so necessary to community organizing. And beyond that, he brought his brilliant and irreverent humor and support to everyone who was fortunate enough to work with him. One person wrote that, quote, "I knew he was a stand-up guy. Bill did the things that without which nothing goes forward. His humor was the kind people use when they plan to slog along until the end of the battle. The friendly fire of baseball chatter that keeps us awake but doesn't distract, that crimps up everyone's energy without wasting any." Unquote. Someone else wrote, quote, "He was the quiet guy until you got to know him, who took minutes and did research, kept people informed, went to numerous meetings and kept us up to date on what was going on, sometimes headed a meeting or spoke at a hearing, and always could write something to make you laugh about and at the bad guys. He didn't want any glory or to be in the spotlight. He just wanted to make a difference, and he loved his job." End quote. I can tell you a million different things that Bill did as part of his job, and that he did with his usual sense of calm and steadfastness, and always with his twisted sense of humor that so delighted us. But what I'd rather do now is tell you about the stunning results of his work. Bill was instrumental in helping to create important community programs that have forever improved the lives of thousands of Champaign County residents. Thanks to Bill, working with others, but it's time to acknowledge Bill's role. Thanks to Bill, our county has a child dental access program that over the past 4 years has provided free dental care to low-income Champaign County children who had no access to dental care. Thanks to Bill, county residents now have a program that provides home nurse visits to elderly or sick people so that they can continue to live in their homes rather than go to nursing homes. Thanks to Bill, our low-income and uninsured community members can now get free and discounted care at our hospitals, where before, our hospitals were aggressively suing and even jailing low-income patients who couldn't pay their medical bills. Thanks to Bill, these aggressive and reprehensible debt collection practices were brought to state and national attention, and now hospitals' debt collection practices are the subject of congressional investigations and legislative efforts. And there are many, many more examples that I can give. Bill would tell you that I'm exaggerating his contribution to these achievements, but I'm not. It took all of us at Healthcare Consumers and so many of you here in this room today to make these changes. And we worked together as a team and as a community. But Bill's contributions, because he stayed out of the public eye, were frequently hidden and rarely celebrated, but always essential and powerful. If I or others of us who were more publicly visible are like the ocean, then Bill is like the powerful current that moved us. As one of our board members put it, Bill was the quiet storm that was forever spreading a calm but firm energy as he worked to bring affordable health care to the underserved and uninsured. His presence was soothing and steady, and he was unfailingly reliable and trustworthy. I want to share with you some of the other things that Bill's co-workers, board members, clients, and community members have said about Bill and what they love about him. Many people have remarked upon Bill's gentle and quiet manner, as well as his sharp and unique sense of humor. I think one of our board members summed it up best when she wrote that Bill was a soft-spoken, gentle man with a mad sense of humor. Others have described Bill as having a razor-sharp wit or dry wit, and have commented that his humor was most visible in his writing or in his low-key or quietly muttered observations. Bill's humor, at times disturbing, insightful, sardonic, irreverent, and always entertaining, has been a tremendous source of pleasure for us. Our work is difficult, and we frequently become weary. But always, Bill's humor and sharp wit would lift our spirits as Bill, in his understated way, would delight us and entertain us. He had a tremendous capacity to see the absurdities in life and make fun of the things and people who deserved it. One of our former co-workers, Brooke Anderson, who now lives in California, wrote that, quote, "It just reminded me of the countless, countless times when I would be having a bad day or just out of sorts, and Bill would make some wise crack or send a witty email that would have me laughing so hard I was in tears. He was so funny." Through his work and relationships, Bill developed a massive network of people whom he appreciated and enjoyed, and he stayed in touch with over email. I believe that Bill emailed hundreds of people regularly, perhaps even nightly, sending them articles, cartoons, and of course, his political and personal observations on any variety of topics, but of course, with his own twisted sense of humor. Bill had tremendous affection and appreciation for people, for his family, his friends, and his coworkers. In a quiet and understated way, he was thoughtful and engaging, and his endearing and unforgettable qualities, his kindness and patience, his brilliant humor, earned him the profound respect and affection of everyone who ever worked with him. For Bill's family, I want you to know that your brother, your uncle, was deeply loved and appreciated by all of us who knew him, and 100 more people who couldn't even be here today. And for those of you who are here today, I can tell you that Bill and I talked frequently about many of you. He would so delight in you all for things that you wouldn't even imagine, but things that were just so quintessentially you. And he had a capacity to appreciate people here and now, a capacity that too many of us have a little too late. But so as I talk to you, if I tell you that he loved you, or that he enjoyed you or appreciated you, that's not just me saying that. We had these conversations. As I reflect on Bill's life over the past 9 years and his social justice work, it's so clear to me that his work was nothing short of heroic. That's a word that Bill would never use to describe himself or his work, but it seems stunningly clear to me. He did one of the hardest jobs in the world, and he did it selflessly, with grace and compassion, always patient and kind and gentle. I believe that the mothers and fathers of the young children who are now getting dental care in our community would consider Bill a hero if they knew that it was his efforts that helped lead to the creation of the program that serves their children. For me, it is the hardest thing in the world to say goodbye to Bill, my best friend. I can't imagine my life and this world without Bill. Bill not only made my life better, his friendship made me better. And in the moments when I feel that my sorrow is unbearable and my legs will buckle and I will fall, I realize that, as it has always been, Bill's enduring love and friendship and his quiet strength is there to lift me up and carry me through. I feel his strength and his love in the friendships and sense of family among all of us who shared in his beautiful and gracious life. And I see that I don't have to imagine a life or world without Bill, because Bill's work and the community he created are an enduring testament to his life. We have been forever changed for the better because of Bill, and his lasting contributions have made our community and our lives infinitely better. I want to close now by reading to you what one of our dear friends wrote about Bill. Jim Holloman, who's here with us today and will speak later, is a retired campus minister from the Illinois Disciples Foundation here and a longtime Healthcare Consumers Board member. Jim and his wife Dolores wrote to tell me about a conversation that they had had about Bill. And they said, "This morning, as we talked about this, a particular image began to take shape. There's a lily in the valley. It's not a new image. Its origin can be found throughout the Psalms. But for us, Bill is a beautiful lily in our lives. And his gifts to us were so very gentle and strong at the same time. We love Bill and we celebrate the gift of his beauty in the valley here. And that does not end here and now." Thank you. And now I'd like to ask Lisa Bell to come up and say a few words. Lisa is the Executive Director of Central Illinois Dental and Education Services, which is an organization that many of us together formed. And Lisa is the director of the Child Dental Access Program, which provides services through for the County Board of Health to the children of Champaign County, and a very beloved friend of Bill's as well.
Hi. I came really close to trying to put together a written statement, and I couldn't make it happen, so I'm going to, it was very, very difficult for me, so I'm going to speak to you only from my heart and hopefully the hearts and souls of the thousands of children and families that my work, because of Bill's support and Bill's strength, provides. I will say this to start. I am a richer and better person for having known Bill, and this community is immensely richer and better for having had him in it. I met Bill about 4.5 years ago. It was simply out of two separate passions in two different areas with one main goal, and that was to provide dental care to the low-income families of Champaign County. And you know, we just sort of ran headlong into one another along with Claudia, and it was sort of like some wild explosion. And within, I don't know, just a handful of months, we were at the crux of having this really wonderful, wonderful program put forth. And it was because of Bill and his passion and his leadership that I'm here today, and that more importantly, the program is still here today. It's a struggle, and I would sit often just so frustrated and so angry, and I would quickly pick up the phone, and the first person I would call would be Bill, and he would just in this very calm voice speak to me, and I'm like, "No, you don't understand, I'm really mad." And he would just be, "It's okay. It's okay." And you know, we'd go off on some tangent about how crazy the healthcare system is, and before I knew it, I felt a whole lot better. And whatever it was that I called to be incredibly frustrated about simply no longer really mattered, and we just sort of moved on, which was amazing. When the organization was first started, out of that came Central Illinois Dental Education, and I can remember frantically putting this little thing together, and those of us who are on the board sitting around this table looking at one another saying, "Well, who's going to take the reins? Who's going to be president of this board? Now we have to have a president, and we have to have an organization, and now we're all here, so who's going to do it?" And we kind of sort of looked around the room, and of course I can't do it because I'm just the employee, and there were several of them sitting around there, and I knew everybody is just amazingly busy with their own lives and their own stuff, and Bill's work at Healthcare Consumers was, I mean, I would get emails from 24 hours a day, just like all of you, and you think, "Do you ever sleep?" And there can't be one iota of extra time that you could possibly have. Who do you think became president of our board that evening? Bill did. And without him, and without his leadership, and his writing ability that I heard someone speak about earlier, you know, we would write grants, and Karen in the back, who is just instrumental in that as well. Bill would research them. He'd spit them out for us, and Karen would somehow put his words to paper and make it happen. And it was very fun, and an amazing experience for me that I intend to carry on because of Bill. There's obviously times where you just think, that's it. But I have no greater drive to succeed and no greater drive to see this program continue for many years now than I've ever had in my life. And it is because I want to continue to honor Bill and the work that he did within this community and will continue to do through our hands and our hearts for many, many, many years. I would close and say I can remember, and I spoke to Michelle about this once, and she said, that's exactly what he was trying to do. I was a healthcare provider. I'm a dental hygienist. I didn't know about, running organizations and writing grants and doing all of that. And it was sort of a trial by fire. And Bill nurtured me. And I felt, and I spoke about this once before, like I was his little bitty bird in this nest, and he just kind of hovered over me and took really good care of me. And then over time, he was kind of pushing me. And I kept, being the hungry bird, I kept, crawling, just kind of clawing back for more, and he kept pushing and pushing and pushing. And I kind of thought, well, what is he doing? Why is he doing this to me? And he was pushing me to succeed. And actually, a handful of months ago, I think he gave me the big boot in the butt and told me to get out of the nest and do what he knew I had the possibility, the capability of doing. So I'm going to feel that boot in my butt and this huge boot in my chest from loss and grieving. I will feel both of them for an amazingly long time, but hopefully the one in my butt a little bit more arduously, because that will help us all to move on, and it will help me personally to move on, knowing that he's laid the groundwork for so many of us in this community, so many organizations. I am pleased to be here. Thank you so very much for including me.
Thank you, Lisa. It's hard to think about the work around the child dental program without also thinking about many other people, including Karen Boyda, who served on the County Board of Health at the time, and Michelle Spading, who helped make this happen, and also Bob Kirshner, who's here. Bob has been like our guardian on so many things, protecting so many programs that we care about, and Bill really respected and held Bob in highest regard, so thank you, Bob, also for all your work. And the next person to speak is Michelle Spading, who is a very dear friend of the organizations, of Bill's family. She is, some of you might know her as a former County Board of Health member. She was one of the original Friends of Public Health who helped create the Champaign County Health Department through voter referendum that many of you participated in. And she was one of Bill's very closest friends, and she was also his partner for a couple of years, and I think one of the people who helped make Bill's life the happiest that it ever was. And so I'm going to ask Michelle to come up and say a few words.
Well, first of all, I just want to say, and I need to say, that I feel very honored and blessed that Bill let me into his life and was able to share a part of him that I truly fell in love with. He was always very loving, very kind and respectful to me and to my family. He was someone who could be ignored so easily, and since he was so shy and never wanted to be in the limelight, he often people didn't get to know him as well as some of us did. And it took some time to really get to know him, but it was so very, very worth it. He was truly a wonderful friend and a companion. I think Bill's greatest weakness, personally, is that he cared just almost too much. He would internalize people's pain and suffering, and he would brood about it, And I think this is where his infamous humor came in. This was how he dealt with it the best. He was always able to see the absurdity in the situation, and he'd get very frustrated that others couldn't. He could use his humor and sarcasm to relieve the frustration and anger and helped us all by sharing it, as Claudia said. And as many other people have said, he could send an email or say something when he saw you that could always make you laugh or lighten your day, lighten that cloud that was over your head. If only I could have done the same for him. After 2 years of a rather close and intimate relationship, we were still able to keep a wonderful friendship. Many times people can't say that. Not that we ever fought, we just drifted apart and as our worlds changed. He would still continue to email me updates about his family and keep in touch with my daughter and my sister's family in New Mexico, sending them emails as well with all the different things they were interested in. He always asked how I was and shared in my joys and my sadness, wanting so much to do anything to change anything that was a hardship for me. And he would never just say that. With Bill, it was so sincere. You knew he really meant it. He would do anything to make you feel better, anything to take away the pain. He would always talk about the hotline advocates and the new volunteers that would come in. He just loved to have the new people come in. He would always tell me about how great they all were, what their interests were, what their goals were. He absolutely loved to see young people involved in social justice. And I think that's obvious in his love for his nieces and nephews and the influence he had on them and on my own daughter, who's 17. And in fact, I'm wearing this t-shirt tonight because it's one that Bill gave her, and she could not be here tonight, so she asked that I wear it. And just a little bit, a little story about their relationship. My daughter, Emily, totally enjoyed his humor once she got to know him. And sometimes the two of them could be a real handful together. They both had this kind of irreverence about certain traditions and religious rules and regulations, which was sort of ironic since Emily went to a Catholic high school. When my daughter needed to do a report on a not-for-profit organization who used volunteers, her first choice was CCHCC. Not exactly one of the choices put forth by her Catholic high school. But it met the criteria, and she knew she would have the support of myself and Bill and many others to get the work done she needed. So, and of course, of all the programs that they do, she chose the early contraception campaign. So let's just say there was at least one rather painful confrontation at her high school, but she handled it well. She made her point and presented her material in a way that was acceptable to administration, although not to the priest. Now, that may seem like a small thing, but it is things like this that build great self-confidence in young people at a time when developmentally they're trying so hard to build, to find their own self-identity, and it can be very powerful. So I want to thank you, Bill. So there is a huge void in my life with Bill gone, just as in everyone's life. And he would be upset and he would be pained to know of the many regrets that I have for not being as good a friend to him as he was to me, or maybe not being there for him and as he was for me and for other people. But he's going to have to let me have those regrets, because it's from these that I will continue to grow and change, and hopefully incorporate some of those traits in my own life to help me be a better person. I have so many, many wonderful memories, and I've gained many friends from knowing Bill, especially his sister Anne and her family, who we've come to know so well and have become important people in our lives. I have very much to be thankful for. Bill always made me feel good, gave me the strength to keep fighting the good fight, and now he needs to let me grieve, as well as all of you, his loss with his friends and family. One thing I know is that grieving takes time, and a sudden loss, such as Bill's, takes even longer. It really shakes our world. There is no opportunity to say goodbye, or unfinished business. So opportunities like tonight provide a beginning, not an end. As the numbness begins to wear off and we work through our grief together, each in our own individual way. It's often a very dark and confusing path as we follow our work through grief, and it's very inconsistent with the sadness and the anger and the denial and the guilt all mixed up with all those happy memories that we have. But Bill left us all a wealth of friendship and caring in his path, and I know that together we can hopefully continue to share his memories, his accomplishments, his wicked humor, and his witty stories, and perhaps in time find some comfort and some resolution. There's a saying I've loved that probably sounds very sentimental, but it has great meaning to me and embodies how I feel about Bill. Some people come into our lives and quickly go. Some people move our souls to dance. They awaken us to new understanding with the passing whisper of their wisdom. Some people make the sky more beautiful to gaze upon, and they stay in our lives for a while, leave footprints on our hearts, and we are never, ever the same. Thank you for the dance, Bill. Your footprints will always be on my heart. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. I know this is very hard to do. Now, we want to turn things over to Bill's family, and I just wanted to invite Crone, Bill's youngest brother, to come up if you want, and then I know nieces and nephews are here. I don't know, Crone, if you want to come up first or if you all want to come up together. But as you're doing that, I wanted to mention that I brought a couple of gifts. These were gifts for Bill. We were in the habit around our office of like giving each other things, whether it was books or, you know, just different things. And we weren't always very timely with the gifts. Like, my birthday's at the end of January, and I might end up with a gift without any note or anything on my desk, like, you know, in late February or something. And if there was never a note with it, I always knew it was from Bill. And it could be anything silly or serious or anything like that. And so here are the couple of the gifts that we've been sitting on for Bill, and I just want to give them to the family, and y'all can do with it as you wish. The first is a Christmas present from me to Bill, and it's, I just never got around to bringing it in, but I think Bill would forgive me because that's the way it was. This is the disappearing civil liberties mug, so as you fill it up with hot liquid, your liberties disappear. I did give him on time a dog poop calendar for Christmas. A beautiful calendar with scenes of the outdoors, but there was dog poop in every one of them. That's not so much about me as it is about Bill. And then when Allie, Katie, and I went to Washington, D.C. in January to the annual Families USA conference, we went to this little shop around the corner called the Chocolate Moose. That's where this bag is from. And this is really embarrassing. Again, not so much for me and Allie and Katie, but for Bill. But we found the perfect gift for him that we thought would delight and amuse him. And I am only sorry that I didn't get my stuff together enough to have it sit on his desk and have him find it. So I'm giving it to the family. It's poop, and it's got a string, and you pull it, and it vibrates. So Bill would have liked that, and I'm going to turn that over to the family.
Hi, I'm Crone, and I don't know if I can use this microphone any better than my brother could. Jeff made a... Claudia's helping me as she did with Bill. Our family's been blessed with the great ability to speak in public, and you'll see as I try to go on here that I've acquired the talents Bill had quite nicely. But I have a large folder here, and over the last 3 weeks, I first tried to compose a short eulogy at the memorial service we had in Springfield for Bill. And what we did there was the people that knew Bill growing up, they all had their own memories about him, but what most of them didn't know is what Bill had been doing over here with you folks, and we thought it more appropriate to turn the mic over to Claudia so that people there would know that this wasn't the same kid that used to terrorize the neighborhood, throw snowballs at cars, you know, all the things he did. So I guess in a similar vein over here, you people have known Bill, what he stood for, what his life ultimately stood to mean, both for him and hopefully for the community that he was trying to help. But what I thought I might try to do in some small way, I've got lots of notes here, I've been writing crap down for 3 weeks, and none of it, I start writing something, and then it seems inappropriate, then I start writing something else, and I've got notes, well, anyway. But perhaps, you know, if I tell you a couple of stories about Bill that I think may have, in some fashion, molded him into the person that you all grew to perhaps appreciate. I kept hearing in what people said something about a twisted sense of humor, and I'm not really sure what anybody's talking about. Or irreverent. I have no idea. I mean, this is just our little Bill. I'm Bill's younger brother. We have an older brother who couldn't be here today. I'm the younger brother who shared a bedroom with Bill for the first 3 or 4 years of my life. At the reception following the memorial in Springfield, I think it was Paulette who said, "Oh, you're that brother." And I couldn't quite understand as I looked at her, I couldn't read her thoughts to know if she assimilated my admission to being that brother with whatever Bill told her about those few years. But in any event, I was in fact that brother, and of course there are a lot of stories about that, but if I shared all the funny stories we had together, you'd be here too long, and Bill would in fact come down and smite me. But Bill, for me as an older brother, was, you know, not to be, well, he, as an older brother, he was closest to me in age, somebody I always looked up to. But more importantly, you know, while I was tagging along with them, or trying to tag along with them, much to his chagrin sometimes, he was always somebody that would go out of his way to help me. If I was tagging along with him and his friends, one winter he essentially carries me home when my feet become too frostbitten, even though he was out playing with his friends and wanted to stay out with him. I could always count on him to help me out. And I prepared a long list of things that we'd done together as kids that don't really seem relevant now, plus the fact that since I need bifocals, I can't read the damn thing anyway. But I did want to share a few stories, and I forgot one of my props. But first one, Claudia had mentioned the poop calendar and the vibrating poop, and that's something I've never seen. But, thank you. But I will say this, when Bill was a young child, it was probably about 4 or 5, and Ann could better tell the story because I was an infant at the time, but I've heard it so many times it seems like I was there. Just to give you an idea of what Bill as a 4 or 5 year old would do, he was sitting around the neighborhood one day with his friend Marty Roland, and they were trying to think up new dirty words. This just seemed like a normal thing for them to do. Now at 4 or 5, your command of language is perhaps a little less than Bill's ultimately became, but the only one that anybody can remember, the only still extant dirty word, or actually more appropriately a dirty phrase they came up with, was mashed yellow bee. Now, I'm not sure exactly what that meant, but this to Bill and Marty was the funniest damn thing we've ever heard. But I think this little exercise that they went through perhaps drove home for Bill the idea that language is a powerful tool, that profanity used appropriately and well can assist in driving home a point and can make life itself and language more colorful. I want to move forward to another event. There were some comments made about Bill muttering this and that under his breath. And again, as family members, I'm not sure we ever saw him doing that. But when Bill was probably about 7 or 8 years old, he went to Butler Grade School in Springfield. And Butler, every year, of course, you take the bus trip to Lincoln's Home. If you live in Springfield, you get tired of going to Lincoln's Home. You get tired of going to New Salem. And it's just same old stuff. One of the things we did annually was we went to Lincoln Memorial Gardens, which is a natural area on the banks of Lake Springfield. So you take the bus out there, and Uncle Bob and Billy, who were the caretakers of the facility, would split the busload of kids into two groups and take them along the trail, pointing out different bits of nature. And Bill, being Bill at that time, had taken along for this trip, I couldn't find them. I went all over town last night looking for them. But some of you may remember the old 39-cent binoculars you used to be able to get at Kresge's. I don't think they're available anymore because kids poke their eyes in them. But you couldn't even see your hand in front of your face using these things. But Bill takes us along on the nature trip. So they're walking through the woods, and Billy would point out, oh, now this is an oak tree. And so Bill would, in his animated way, start going, this went on as they approached the lake. And as they got to the lake, you know, the caretakers were doing their best, or whichever one. I think it was Billy. But in any event, you know, trying to ignore them, and so they get down to the lake, and she points to the lake and says, oh, look, there's a mother duck and her ducklings. Bill gets out his binoculars and in his usual fashion, looks at the ducks, and says,
isn't that just ducky?
Well, at this point, Bill was sent back to the bus, waiting for the rest of the nature tour to be completed. But I wonder if perhaps this incident taught Bill that perhaps he should mutter his sarcastic comments less audibly. We jump ahead to junior high school, and I don't want to go through that. I'm trying to get through this quickly, but I'm going off text and from my recollection. But Bill went to Ben Franklin Junior High School. At that time, and I think even to this day, Ben Franklin, even though they're charged with dealing with the throngs of kids in the throes of puberty, for some reason they view it as their duty to run the school like a military school, that somehow or another this is going to help the kids get through puberty better. And at the same time, I, at least in that era, I think there was an effort to induce conformity in the kids, which obviously in Bill's case was a great failure. But in spite of the efforts of a rigid, controlled environment, Bill did find some outlet for his creativity at that time. He took a class in home economics and developed a love for the culinary arts that, you know, some of you may not have known about. So in about seventh grade, Bill convinces my parents that having just taken this course, that he should prepare dinner. And they said, well, that's a good idea. And so what Bill prepares, he takes a hot dog and he cooks hot dogs, puts them on a impales them on a stick, he dips them in ketchup, and then sprinkles crunched up cornflakes on the outside of these things. Now, I can't imagine that a home economics teacher, even at Ben Franklin Junior High School, would have taught anybody to make anything that disgusting. I can only assume, and I've not called his old friends to ask him this, but it would be unlike Bill and his friends Chip Weisbaum and Tom Bruner, on their way home from school, to have dreamed this damn thing up. I just like him. And the other reason I remember the story is that Ann and I then had to go to my father and get some money so we could go to McDonald's and get more coffee at this stage. We jump ahead to high school, which wasn't much better for Bill. He was primarily, for the most part, unchallenged there as he had been. Bill was, you know, you probably already know that, but was exceedingly bright. The one teacher that did challenge him there and taught him to write, or at least write well, nobody else liked, Bernice Rappel. She's a very large, very imposing woman, and wouldn't put up with anybody putting forth anything less than their full effort. And Bill, in some way, met his match with her, but he also, I think, was the only person I know that really, truly liked her. But Bill tells a story, used to tell a story about a class with Bernice, and I was reminded of this again, and looking at the clips that Jeff had made of the speeches Bill gave, and you cannot imagine how difficult it was for him to get up in front of a group of people and say anything. And some of that may have gone back to a speech he had to give for Bernice Rappel's class. And in the, you know, in his usual fashion, Bill's kind of muttering and stuttering his way through it. I don't even know what the topic is. But about midway through this, Bernice picks up a blackboard eraser, throws it across the room at Bill, beams him with it, and says, sit down, Bill. And I think, you know, it's a tragic story in some respects. Bill thought it was pretty funny. And, you know, probably didn't do much for his self-confidence in terms of getting up in front of a group of people. But I think it perhaps convinced him that, or caused in him a preference for the written as opposed to the spoken. Anyway, just to get through this a little quicker, after high school, Bill went to Knox College for a couple years, did very well there when he was putting forth any effort. I think he was on the dean's list a couple of times. And he transferred to Illinois State, which a lot of people wondered about. Why would you go from a nice, small, private liberal arts college to, you know, a mill like Illinois State? And he told people, well, I got tired of being a name and I wanted to be a number. And that was Bill's explanation. We did very well there and made the dean's list a couple of times, as I remember. Mom and Dad might remember a little better. But at some point after a year or so there, he just kind of dropped out. And I'm not sure why, whether he became disillusioned and started asking himself, you know, what the hell is the end of this? I mean, where is this going? Bill then spent about the next 10 years, and I guess the best way I can put it is that he was poet in residence at the Wooden Nickel Tavern in downtown Springfield. He worked at a job that I think he ultimately became very disillusioned with, just didn't enjoy the work. But, you know, during those years, his storytelling became legendary. Nobody could tell a story quite like Bill, turn a short story into a very long one like Bill, sort of like I'm doing now. But you know, even to this day, people that knew Bill from that period will begin a story by saying, well, I can't tell the story like Billy Mueller did, but Bill, at some point, I think, grew tired of just hanging out and not doing anything. He got tired, as somebody would say, of hurling invectives at the world and decided, in fact, maybe it was better to go out and do something in the world. And so Bill went back to college. First, during the same period of time, he started his volunteer work. He worked at the Sojourn House for Battered Women in Springfield. He was on their hotline. And I think this gave him a lot of personal satisfaction, but more than that, just satisfaction helping other people. So he finished college, came over here to grad school. I graduated from college with high honors. I always hated brothers who were overachieving, but then I only had one that was overachieving. And then he went to grad school here, was elected to Phi Kappa Phi, whatever that is, I sure wouldn't know. But again, Bill, at some point during this newer round of schooling, kind of dropped out, kind of withdrew within himself, I guess, and for lack of a better way of putting it. But somewhere in here, you know, he was diagnosed with diabetes, something he fought till his death, that was, you know, integrally involved in his death. And for a while, when he was diagnosed with diabetes, Bill actually, I thought he'd withdraw from life because he became very obsessed with dealing with it. He read everything he could find about it. He ate pigeon food, bird food as near as I could tell, and did everything to control his blood sugar, but never was really very successful in doing it. And I thought, well, he's going to withdraw from life and just focus on his own ailments. But around that time, he found you folks. And I think that helped him to realize that, yeah, I can spend the rest of my life worrying about myself and my diabetes and not be a part of the greater world at large. But I think through you, he actually, I think it was initially a VISTA volunteer, and he'd done some other work too, but it escapes me now. But I think he really enjoyed and savored the work he did here, and while his life after that was far too short, I think his life was richer because of it, because of the experience. I'm way off my notes here, geez. And Bill was deeply committed to his work here. He talked to us all the time. Maybe he talked to you about us, but he talked to us about you because you all were his family. He took pride in the work you did. He took pride in the successes that people had over here and the awards they got. He'd tell us all of these things. He was as proud of you as he would have been if you had been his biological brothers and sisters. And I mean that. In his work here, he could also apply the many talents that he had acquired, sometimes in a harder way, over his lifetime. His studies in history, including particularly American history, and within that, minority studies and studies of the history of labor unions for freedom and justice. His studies in sociology and symbolic interaction, which helped him to recognize the tried and true methods of those in power to denigrate those who were not in power. And his brilliant ways with the pen, drawing on his cynicism and contempt to expose the inanities of the opposition. And in a lot of respects, you gave him an outlet for all of these talents, however irreverent they might sometimes express themselves. As I was reading, over the last few weeks, I've read way too much and thought way too much about all of this, or maybe not, but I was reading an introduction to a collection or an essay by W.E.B. Du Bois, and it was probably the last major speech given by Martin Luther King Jr. before his assassination. And he was talking about Du Bois and Du Bois's impact on the civil rights movement and the causes of social justice in general. And King wrote, "History had taught him," meaning Du Bois, "that it is not enough for people to be angry. The supreme task is to organize and unite people so that their anger becomes a transforming force." And King continued, "Du Bois's greatest virtue was his committed empathy with all the oppressed and his divine dissatisfaction with all forms of injustice. Today we are still challenged to be dissatisfied. Let us be dissatisfied until every man can have food and material necessities for his body, culture and education for his mind, freedom and human dignity for his spirit. Let us be dissatisfied until this pending cosmic elegy will be transformed into a creative psalm of peace, and justice will roll down like waters from a mighty stream." Bill came to his work much later in life than a lot of you, hopefully, but it was a long road there, but it was a road I think he'd always been, maybe he never figured out that was the road he needed to be on, but ultimately I think it was. And I had a quote here that wasn't really appropriate, but and I've actually started to proselytize now, and Bill may just come down and knock me off the stage here. You know, if he were with us, he would have cut me off long ago and saved me from myself. One thing that occurred to me, though, just in leaving you here, a number of years back, I met a gentleman named Ken Heckler, who at that time was in the faculty at Marshall and I think was Secretary of State of West Virginia. Is that where Marshall is? I can't remember. But Ken Heckler had served in the Truman administration and was the author of A Bridge Over Remagen. But the very interesting guy, he had worked very hard for social justice himself over a very long lifetime. And Heckler said as he was getting ready to leave to go down to St. Louis to catch a plane, and he noted on the way up, he passed by Mount Olive, Illinois, where the Mother Jones Monument is, and he asked about it. And he said, "You know, to be honest, I've passed by that for about 40 years, and I've never been there either." He said, "Well, you know, I have a picture in my office of Mother Jones, and she's always there staring down at me. And if ever I feel like I'm starting to get complacent, that I think my work's done, I look up at her and think, what the hell would she say about that?" And so, as I leave you, you know, if there's one memory you could have of Bill, you don't have to put a picture of him up or a picture of John Lee up, but if you can keep their images in mind and consider what they would think if you ever got complacent. They wouldn't want it, and that's about all I have. But thank you.
Since I am not graced with his fantastic ability to write witty, clever speeches, this will not be the most eloquent creation you've ever heard. Uncle Bill is one of the coolest uncles you could ever imagine. Just being around him and listening to him talk, and of course murmur his little editorial comments under his breath, which he would do more loudly sometimes at like Christmas. There are too many of us there. It's nice. It was always one of the highlights of going to holidays in Springfield. I have this picture that I brought with me that was helping me. He and I are talking, and we both look like we even thought, of course. It was just fun. They always gave the best t-shirts, and they always, you know, gave the best books. It was always political books, and he introduced me to Molly Ivins, of course, and he would give me t-shirts that, you know, they're always political or obscene in some way. And they were just, and since it came from Uncle Bill, I could wear it, you know. So, and he always sent the best cards, and I showed Claudia this one earlier. This is one of my favorites, and I got it like last year, well, a week after my birthday probably. I mean, it's a Mueller family tradition. You can't get it on time. It's just, it's like sacrilege in our family. And so he always sent the greatest cards, and you'd read the card, and the card would be funny, and then he would write something, and it would just, I mean, make the card look like nothing, because his comments were always better. But I realized this year, on my birthday, which was the day of the service, that I won't get it anymore. And it really made me realize how much I really looked forward to getting those, and just how cool they were, and how cool he was. And now my email inbox is filled with all this random junk, advertising obscene medications and procedures and offering these fabulous opportunities to obtain free things. But it doesn't have the 4, 6, 10 more emails every day that I would get from Uncle Bill. And I know I'm not the only one in this room who is suffering from a lack of enlightening informative emails at the moment. I actually had to go in search of these things now. And I'm not as good. I'm trying. I'm really glad to be here around so many people who know him and love him and can possibly understand the loss that I feel right now. I don't really know what I will do without him, but the impact he has had on my life is profound and lasting. I have nothing but extreme respect. I have nothing but extreme respect and love for him, and I always will. My mom and I were out one day, and we were at this little shop in downtown Normal, and she found something that she thankfully did not show me at the time, but showed me later, and it just seemed to fit him perfectly in this situation, and it's called Landscape of the Heart, and it says, "It is still so new, and all we see is the empty space, but that is not how it is in the landscape of the heart. There is no empty space, and he still laughs and grapples with ideas and plans and nods wisely with each of us in turn. We are proud to have known him. We are proud to have called him friend. To me, he is an uncle, mentor, and friend. My life and the lives of so many have been changed for the better because of him, and I could never adequately express my extreme gratitude for just the opportunity to know him and be part of his life, just grow up with him. And not a day goes by when I don't think of him, and I will miss him for the rest of my life. And Claudia, we have this for you. This is what we found.
Thank you. Again, I wanted to thank Bill's family for coming out here and sharing with us. And a bunch of us are wearing different t-shirts. They have something to do with Bill. That's why I didn't dress up today and why so many of us are wearing t-shirts. The next person and the last speaker before we go into film clip and slideshow is another very dear friend
of Bill's and of many of ours, and that's Reverend Jim Holland. Jim?
I think I first met Bill at a demonstration during Welfare Reform Day. And there were a lot of homeless people there because they weren't happy with the bill that was before Congress at that time. And I found Bill standing sort of in the background, and I joined him and we began to talk, and I found a very interesting, lively brain that I was talking with. And he was a deep brain. Not a surface kind of discussion that we were engaged in. So, a friendship developed. He did for Claudia, he wrote some of my speeches. Claudia would give me some task, and I didn't know what I was talking about. So I would approach Bill, and Bill would find out what it was, and then would write something up. An outline form, because he knew I wouldn't follow his text verbatim. Too much prayer work in it. So, out of that kind of experience, and particularly in the dialysis task force, where he introduced me to HIPAA and a bunch of other regulations and actually legal lawlessness in many cases with regarding the treatment of diabetics. And we would talk in the parking lot after those meetings up at Provena or at the dialysis center. And we would debrief about the meeting, and there was always something of importance that you don't want to pass on. So it's out of those kinds of contexts that I began to think friendship. Being a minister, I think about these things in a theological way. So you'll have to excuse me. Not that there's anything wrong with theology. It's a lot better than economics or politics. But friendship in the prophetic tradition of struggle for social justice is not a matter of special interest or of goals or of purpose. All of those things can be institutionally established and organized and then protected by some profession, be it secular or religious, or it could be surrounded by laws and security systems. So these things are not very lasting, particularly if you have to have a security system. For example, I understand from a discussion yesterday at the Medicare Part D program that we have five security teams, SWAT teams in this community. So what the hell is going on in this community that's so insecure? That's right, Laura. I think you should find out, Mayor.
Yeah, I probably should.
It has something to do with our budget, I'm sure. Well, in biblical terms, friendship is called discipleship. It is known by the bonds of solidarity existing among those who are summoned to the prophetic struggle for social justice. Now, I don't know when or where or how Bill first was confronted with this summons. Perhaps it was in the bar deciding point here. But during these past 10 years, all of us here were blessed by Bill's answer. And it's flowering in his own life and work. In one of his recent emails, he questioned me about another friend, Robert McAfee Brown, one of the few liberation theologians in this country. Unfortunately, Brown passed on in 2001. He was a leader during the civil rights movement, during the anti-Vietnam War movement, during the early days of the feminist movement, He was active in the sanctuary movement and was one of our saints in that movement. He was one of the disciples who worked within the sanctuary, providing shelter and advocacy for Central American refugees who were seeking political asylum in this country and being denied it because they were viewed as economic immigrants, not as people who were fleeing violence in their homeland. And because this institution was one of the public sanctuaries in the United States, Bill had become curious about how relationships developed and how they sustained the struggle to protect people fleeing violence both in Central America and here, and how the movement sought to stop U.S. imperial intervention in Central America. So Bill was thinking pretty deep about a lot of things. I certainly learned more about the laws of this country than I ever wanted to know during that period. So together he and I were learning that friendship does not end in either intellectual clarification or spiritual illumination, whatever those things are, but with the beauty and glory when discipleship is called to task. It's transforming life. And you and I know it, so that we can live a more just and fair way than we are. Bill used to quote this passage from Isaiah, the 58th chapter, verse 12. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of the streets in which people may dwell in safely. End of quote. The image of Bill, a lily of the valley, emerged as Dolores and I talked about this flower in our life. Now, the origin of that image is found in Scripture. It's found, in fact, in a very sensual love song, which is found in the Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 1. It's interesting that lily of the valley grows out of a sensual love song. Bill knew a lot about that. Its beauty and glory is then contrasted in the next verse to the brambles in the valley's environment. Prophetic people struggling for social justice celebrates the lily of the valley, a sign of the beauty and love of God for all creation, for all creatures, great and small. It is a symbol of the liberator of the whole human family inhabiting the valley. In this vision, the lily is the sign of the resurrection, of the uprising of those hungering and thirsting for transforming of the valley. Bill was interested in what I knew about Archbishop Oscar Romero of El Salvador, because he was known as the people's bishop. The bishop resisted oppression by the country's oligarchy. He once stood before the Joint Chiefs of Staff of the Salvadorian National Guard and commanded, "Stop the killing." Perhaps someone should do that for our own Joint Chief of Staff. He was a peacekeeper. Once, when the military had surrounded a congregation in their church and was threatening to kill them all, the bishop walked forth and placed his own body between those soldiers and his congregation. He made radio broadcasts in which he filed for all the world to know claims of war crimes being committed against his own people by his own military. And the people, much like those that we've talked about who surrounded Bill, began to surround the bishop and sought to protect him. They sought to follow him. And he was a good shepherd, but the oligarchy counted him to be a sheep to be slaughtered. And so on the night before he was assassinated in March of 1980, he confessed a sure and certain hope. "My life has been threatened many times," he said. "I have to confess that, as a Christian, I don't believe in death without resurrection. If they kill me, I will rise again in the struggle of the Salvadorian people. I am not boasting here or saying this out of pride, but rather as a servant." And that's how I remember Bill, a lily of the valley, whose uprising even here, now, and in this place.
Now we are ready to with you, and then you'll also see some photos from throughout his life. And so we're ready to do that. And I guess one of the last things that I wanted to say is I wanted to thank everybody who helped to submit photos and so on. I wanted to give a special and heartfelt thanks to Jeff Machota, who put together the booklet that you all have, and also put these together for all of us. Thank you, Jeff.
Some of the providers' representatives, and some people weren't generally known for exhibiting much sense of camaraderie or connection with the rest of us or with the larger community. They had to actually go embarrassed. And Carmen, you're the only person who's going to pull that up. For that and many other things, Carmen, it gives us great pleasure to present you with the Harry J. Baker Community Service Award.
Push
central piece of legislation in the guise of Medicare reform and prescription drug relief that even now is buckling everyone's mind how bad it is. He's reduced veterans' health benefits while sending our young people into an obscene war. He's advocated before the Supreme Court against the right of states to give their citizens the rights to sue HMOs. He's pushed and continues to push for caps on malpractice awards for patients harmed by incompetent physicians. He's opposed all efforts by individual cities and states to rein in prescription drug expenses. And I'll just leave it at that. You have your own, and he deserves it. No question. Thank you.
Oh,
Thank you all so much. This concludes the formal part of this gathering. I want to leave you with a quote. And when we're done with this, we just unwind and hang out and have some food, and folks are welcome to stay for as long as everybody's willing to hang out. One of the biggest gifts that that Bill gave to so many of us is to teach us how to have fun while we work and struggle together as friends, brother and sister, comrades. And he loved this quote from Molly Ivins and encouraged me to use it as much as possible. So I want to read it to you in honor of Bill. She says, "So keep fighting for freedom and justice, beloveds, but don't you forget to have fun doing it."